The murder of Billy Bat is one of the absolutely central scenes of Goodfellas, and the film emphasises it by showing Bat brutally being finished off at the very beginning of the film, before we know anything significant about the main characters or the plot itself. So the entire story is instantly framed by Bat's murder, with Henry looking off into the distance as if asking, how the hell did I get involved in this gangster insanity? When people opt for a life of organised crime, it comes with the risk of this happening. But also the scene establishes how dangerous Tommy is. So when we get further into the story and Tommy threatens Henry, although the murder of Bats hasn't happened yet in the story chronology, we already know about the ugly, sadistic, psychopathic side of Tommy. Even if we consciously have forgotten about this opening scene, that underlying awareness is still there deep down when he threatens Henry. A demonic red glow from the rear lights of the car paints the scene like a vision of hell. It's very significant that Tommy pulls out a kitchen knife instead of a gun, like he usually does when he wants to get violent. Stabbing a guy repeatedly is more shocking than the distant, hands-off behaviour of shooting them. There's no practical reason he'd use the knife instead of his gun, so the point here is to show his bloodthirst, his sadism, his cruelty. And same goes for De Niro's character Jimmy. Why is he holding a shovel instead of pulling out the gun, which he ends up using anyway? I think the basic point was to allow Tommy to show his butcherous side before the gun execution itself. Henry not taking part and looking off in the distance like he's asking, what the hell am I involved with here? This immediately establishes the inner conflict that is with him through most of the story. He likes the perks that gangster life brings, but wishes the danger and cruelty wasn't a part of the package. And that schizophrenic duality is contrasted by the inappropriate use of upbeat music used to end a very shocking opening scene.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
Most gangster films would end a scene like this with some dramatic music, but it's not needed here. What we've seen is bad enough. It's also important that we don't get a very good look at Billy Bats. We don't even want to because he's so beat up and bloody, and he isn't named in the dialogue of this scene. That's clever because it means when we finally get to see Bats just before his murder, we're unlikely to recognise that it's him on first viewing. We're also given a rough date and location for this event, New York 1970. And that's another clever, almost subliminal detail because when we come to the full scene that shows Bats getting into a fight with Tommy, it begins with a date and location as well. June 11th, 1970, Queens, New York. So it's not the exact same caption as the opening scene, it's an expansion, but for anyone astute enough to remember the early caption, it's a very definite clue as to what's about to happen in this scene. And it's not the only clue. The camera creeping in toward the bar is a clue of something important about to unfold. That's a part of the unwritten code of cinematography. Have the camera creep in slowly towards a location or an actor. This typically signifies that a certain scene or piece of dialogue is to be marked out for special audience attention. And when that angle is low down, as it is here, it merely adds to the creeping effect. One way of thinking about it is that we're creeping up like a cat to see something that we're not supposed to see. I mean, the curtains are drawn in the windows, and the camera stops just short of the end of this shot. It doesn't attempt to cross the road. It's like there's a hesitation to get closer to the building. So yes, we're eavesdropping essentially. And there's also the music here. Though it's a pop song, the opening bars have a subliminal dramatizing effect similar to horror music.
I always dreamed the boy I love would come along. And he'd be tall and handsome, rich and strong. Now that boy I love has come to me, but he sure ain't the way I thought he'd be.
So cut to inside the forbidden location and we see the jukebox first. This lets us know that the music we're hearing is incidental. It's not a representation of what's actually happening in the scene, emotionally or thematically. Pan across all the balloons and party paraphernalia to Billy Bats talking to a down-dressed guy who might be a bodyguard or a relative or something. The limited number of people and the spatial setup between characters establishes a few things already. First, this isn't a party, it's the aftermath of a party, and these are the people that are left. We don't know it yet, but this is Henry's business establishment. And so Henry, sat far away staring at Billy, suggests that he's waiting for Billy to leave. Billy Bats has probably overstayed his welcome. Henry and Jimmy and some other guy being sat so far away, there's a feeling of emotional distance between these little groups of people. There's only 5 of them in total, so why aren't they all sat together, or at least near enough along the bar to facilitate a little cross-pollination of conversation? They're not close buddies, so it seems Bats has simply rented Henry's venue for the occasion, and that's as close as the relationship gets. It looks to me here like Henry has had enough, he just wants to close shop and go home, but then 2 more people arrive. Why are they getting here so late? Did Bats call them and invite them over? The opening lyrics, by the way, are probably being used with relevance to the scene.
Always dreamed the boy I love would come along. And he'd be tall and handsome, rich and strong. Now that boy I love has come to me. But he sure ain't the way I thought he'd be.
Someone turning out to be different than they appeared to be. Well, that could be Billy Bats or perhaps Tommy and to a lesser extent Jimmy. They all show their ugly sides here. The welcome home signs above the bar tell us that this isn't a birthday party, and this isn't going to be a military service homecoming, is it? So yeah, someone's just got out of prison. And perhaps that feeling of Bats being let off the leash, as in let out of jail, is part of the problem in this scene. Maybe he's got a lot of pent-up frustrations to release. Maybe years of not being able to boss people around when he was in jail has... Maybe it's built up a compulsion in him to overdo it once he gets out.
Sit down, have a drink. Come on. Give us a drink. Give them all a drink here.
So right away, he's shouting orders to the barman. Verbally, he's not too aggressive, but those hand gestures are like aggressive commands, like the barman is a dog being told to fetch, sit, roll over.
And give those Irish hoodlums a drink down there.
His jokey insult to Henry and Jimmy is likely a little dig for the fact that they aren't joining in his conversation, but Bats is clever. His insult is delivered while ordering them a drink. He frames his personal attacks on others as jokes and packages them with distracting compliments. Essentially, he's pointing out that they aren't Italian, which means they can't join a gangster crew like the one Bats is a member of. He's reminding them of their inferior status in the gangster world, and Jimmy is straight onto this and defies him.
And give those Irish hoodlums a drink down there.
There's only one Irishman here.
Jimmy's taken ownership of the insult, letting Bats know that he knows the insult is directed at him personally, not at he and Henry, as Bats had framed it. And Henry is onto it as well and speaks his approval of Jimmy's response.
There's only one Irishman here.
Yeah. It's a celebration, fellas. Salute.
Bats keeps up the pretense, though. But again, the way he uses his hands suggests something more domineering. Hand straight up, I'm the centre of attention, never mind your own conversation, and his forefinger pointing upward, like he's ready to give out more commands. Jimmy continues his defiance by proudly reaffirming his Irish identity.
It's a celebration, fellas. Salute.
Top of the morning to you.
Good to be home.
Welcome back.
And Bats follows up by saying it's good to be home. Not that this is his home, it's Henry's place, and Henry gives a very unenthusiastic welcome back.
Top of the morning to you.
Good to be home.
Welcome back.
So even before Tommy enters the fray, these guys don't like each other much at all. It's a fake party atmosphere. So now in waltzes Tommy with another of his many girlfriends. And he looks bored the moment he walks in. Maybe he was hoping for a bit of tail, but she kept him out all night buying her drinks and touring venues. He's not in a good mood at all, so the sight and sound of Billy Bats demanding attention immediately grates on his nerves.
This is Lisa.
Hi, Frankie. How are
you? Hey, Tommy, all dressed up. All grown up and doing the town. Look at this.
Oh, shit.
Tommy!
Bats instantly demands that Tommy pay attention to him and to ignore everyone else. Maybe the idea of there being a bigger crowd at the other end of the bar that Bats isn't a part of, maybe that was unacceptable to Bats. Maybe seeing Tommy with a good-looking woman dressed hotly in red while he's womanless, that could be a factor in his response here too. I mean, if he's just got out of prison, has his wife left him? Whatever it is, he immediately does his thing of giving insults and commands, but disguising them behind smiles and supposed compliments.
Frankie, how are you?
Hey, Tommy, all dressed up, all grown up and doing the town. Look at this.
So he's basically calling Tommy a young upstart. Teenagers hate that kind of talk, and to a grown man like Tommy, it's an outright insult. Tommy instantly announces that he doesn't want to talk to Billy at all by ignoring him and mumbling his disapproval. Bats doesn't hear what Tommy whispers, but he did spot the cold shoulder. So Bats slightly ups the aggression and orders Tommy to come to him like a dog.
Tommy!
I forgot you were having a party with this month.
Oh! Oh! Come here!
It's ironic, actually, that Bats is referred to, I think, three times in this scene as a mutt.
Oh, Tommy! I forgot you were having a party with this month.
Oh!
Motherfucking mutt! Fucking
mutt into my shoes.
It's very significant that Bats didn't let Tommy greet his close friends properly before asking for his attention, and that he didn't move from his position at the end of the bar to go over and greet Tommy in person. No, he demands that Tommy snub his friends and come grovelling to him. Tommy sees sense and goes over to greet Billy, who is still slipping the aggression in with orders and an unnecessary bit of swearing.
Come here!
Let me go say hello. Hey, Billy, how are you?
Tommy, get over here. I haven't seen you in six
Billy.
Fucking years.
How you doing, Billy?
Jesus Christ almighty. You look terrific. How you feel?
Watch this suit.
And then he's manhandling Tommy like he's hugging a pet, dominating him even. Not far off getting him into a playfight headlock. Tommy feels the insult and tells him to watch the suit, which is a reasonably diplomatic way of trying to back Bats off, but it's too late. He snubbed Bats upon first contact, and Bats had to shout orders to get Tommy to come and acknowledge his social top dog status. And now Tommy's defying him again by rejecting his hugs. So Bats lets the mask slip a little now. He loses his cool and says something totally unnecessary.
Watch this suit, you little prick, you...
Ouch. Tommy definitely considers the word prick an insult because he used that word himself when he was dominating Henry and friends in Sonny's restaurant.
Stuttering prick, yeah. Look at this prick.
And we can see the anger on his face right away at this. But there's also the wordplay of calling Tommy a little prick. Tommy has a complex about being shorter than other men, as outlined in my breakdown of the restaurant scene. So, a double raw nerve attack from Bats.
Watch this suit,
you little prick, you.
I think there's almost definitely a parallel here between how Tommy demanded to be the centre of attention in this scene and Bats doing the same here. In both instances, the tough guy just wants to be liked and loved, or at least appear to be liked and loved in the eyes of bystanders. As Henry said at the start of the movie, in his voiceover, I knew everybody and everybody knew me. But these two guys have a compulsion to try and force that positive response from others through fear. Pander to me or I'll insult you. Grovel to me or I'll kill you. Such an attitude is frustrating for these men because you can't bully someone into liking you. It has the opposite effect. The most you can achieve is a fake positivity response. And that's never satisfying. Bats conveys his conflict within himself by ironically grovelling toward Tommy. He doesn't want to get too aggressive, as it would reveal his fragile ego, so he tries to appeal to Tommy like they're literally blood relatives.
You little frick, you. Hey, I know you all my life.
Well, he's a fair bit older than Tommy, so he hasn't known Tommy all his life. All of Tommy's life, maybe, but not his own. And he gives one of those double-meaning statements again.
All right, good.
You're getting too big on me
just
now.
Don't go busting my balls, Billy, okay?
That half sounds like he's portraying himself as Tommy's dad, the blood relative thing again, but he's also reminding Tommy that he is lower down the gangster ranks, just as he did with Henry and Jimmy earlier. Plus he's equating Tommy as being a child in an adult body. And the hand gestures again, pointing at Tommy like he's commanding him to know his place, telling the little doggy to sit and stay. As far as Tommy is concerned, this is a rare situation where he is the one being pressurised into grovelling, and he doesn't like it one bit. So finally he gives a half-hearted fuck you to Bats. He defies him verbally, but does it while he's walking away, as if he fears the response he might get.
All right, good.
You're getting too big on me
just
now.
Don't go busting my balls, Billy, okay?
That's a statement. Go away, Billy. You're annoying, you're pissing me off, and I can't wait to get over to my crowd and away from you and your crowd. All Tommy had to do here was to just give Billy a bit more of an enthusiastic response, look glad to see him, and give a couple minutes of enthusiastic conversation. Hey, better feels good to be out of the joint. How was your stretch? How's the wife and kids? If he's got a wife and kids. What you're up to now you're back in town? What are you going to do with yourself? You know, that kind of thing. That's all it would have took, but then maybe Tommy's got a point. Why should anyone grovel to this guy? When these kind of guys get into a verbal sparring match, neither wants to let the other have the last word, so it just keeps escalating. Tommy tries to get the last word in as he's walking away, and it was almost a threat.
All right, good.
You're getting too big on me
just
now.
Don't go busting my balls, Billy, okay?
Don't go busting my balls or what? Bats knows exactly what's going on, though. He already knows Tommy has pretty much announced he doesn't want to talk to him, and now Tommy is issuing a statement of open defiance, an underhanded threat even. Nah, Billy can't let that one go. So, without hesitation, he decides to start kicking this kid into place.
You're getting too big on me
just
now.
Don't go busting my balls, Billy, okay?
Hey, Tommy, if I was going to break your balls, I'd tell you to go home and get your shine box.
Nobody in the room knows exactly what this refers to, probably, except Tommy. But Bats' own buddies burst into laughter anyway. And only his buddies, not Tommy's crowd, they don't laugh at this. Obviously it involves Tommy polishing something like a good little maid. And being laughed at by a group, of course, infuriates Tommy more than anything. Clever double meaning again here from Bats in his choice of words. He insults Tommy outright, but phrases it as if he isn't insulting him, but that he could insult him if he wanted to.
Hey, Tommy, if I was going to break your balls, I'd tell you to go home and get your shine box.
Little bit of a head spin of that, but it is actually a common wordplay tactic. If I was going to say A to you, then I would say B. It is actually a sophisticated way of making a statement as if you haven't actually said it. It's funny how this ability to engage in wordplay trickery is so important to the criminal underworld life, whether it's gangster rappers or the mafia. So there's a real poetic element to the dialogue in this film, especially this scene. Two well-practiced bullies using a complex barrage of subtleties in verbal and non-verbal communication to win a psychological chess match in front of an audience of other crime world associates, and in the presence of a couple of women too. It's notable how quick Bats was at thinking up the shine box insult as well. He must have had this line of personal attack already in mind to begin with.
Don't go busting my balls, Billy, okay?
Hey, Tommy, if I was going to break your balls, I'd tell you to go home and get your shine box.
Bats now gives his insulting monologue about Tommy's past, essentially calling him a peasant slave worker, but he sneakily words all of this as if it's a gushing compliment.
Oh, this kid was great. They used to call him Spitshine Tommy. I swear to God, oh, he'd make your shoes look like fucking mirrors. Excuse my language. He was terrific. He was the best. And he made a lot of money, too. Salud, Tommy.
The efforts to disguise his outright aggression with a facade of fake politeness and compliments, that's quite a well-oiled technique he's got there. He probably spends half his life talking to people in this way. Even going so far as to swear and then asking to be excused for doing so.
Well, God, he make your shoes look like fucking mirrors. Excuse my language.
And note the camera work. That method of slowly edging the camera towards something signifies importance, as was done in the exterior opening shot of the scene. And here it's used because Bats is going for an all-out personal attack on Tommy, and it's quite a sophisticated one, even finishing with a toast gesture. And then it's over to Tommy for a retort that he can't stop himself from giving, and we have that emphatic creeping camera movement again.
Salud, Tommy.
No more shines, Billy.
What?
I said no more shines. Maybe you didn't hear about it. You've been away a long time. They didn't go up there and tell you. I don't shine shoes anymore.
And Tommy slips in a couple of insults of his own, drawing attention to the fact that Bats has been in prison for years, and so he's not up to date on what's happening in the real world. At the same time, Tommy is rejecting Bats' assessment of his own character and announcing that he's a lot tougher than Bats remembers him to be, and that he takes no abuse off anyone, not even the great Billy Bats. And all delivered with deadpan eye contact and firm voice. It's a hardball response. The creeping camera work continues until Bats and Tommy are both held in close-up. They may be far away from each other in physical space along the bar, but in the language of camera work and editing, they may as well be up close and in each other's faces. Bats didn't expect this tough challenge from Tommy, so, stunned and lacking a witty prepared response, his tough big shot gangster act slips, and he apologises.
I don't shine shoes anymore.
Relax, will you, for crying out? What's got into you? I'm breaking your balls a little bit, that's all. I'm only kidding with you.
Sometimes you don't sound like you're kidding. You know, there's a lot of people around.
Honey, I'm only kidding with you. We're having a party. I mean, I just came home. I haven't seen you in a long time, and I'm breaking your balls, and you're right away, you're getting fucking fresh. I'm sorry. I don't mean to offend you.
Tommy had pretty much won the battle at this point, and he tries to smooth things out with a mutual apology, but it's a half-hearted one.
I'm sorry, too. It's okay. No problem.
Okay, salute.
If he'd apologised while walking over to Billy and giving him a make-up hug, then just having one friendly drink with him, then that would have likely sufficed. But to give a half-hearted apology and then just turn away and leave an incredibly uncomfortable silence hanging in the air, that was never going to work. Bats has been challenged and beaten on top of being somewhat ignored, and there's no way he's going to let that sink in with an uncomfortable silence. And so...
Now go home and get your fucking shine box.
No more pretense now of disguising his motives with complimentary framing. This is straight insult, shouted aggressively.
Motherfucking mutt! You fucking piece of shit!
Come on!
Tommy flips, of course, and this is a preferable outcome for Billy. To him, it's preferable to the uncomfortable silence. And now the audience can see that Tommy is the emotionally unhinged one, and Bats is the calm guy in control, telling everyone not to get nervous. Did he know that Henry would hold Tommy back, thus protecting Billy as he shouts more challenges? That happens in a lot of barroom standoffs. One guy flips and goes on the attack against another because he knows that others will stop him, or he gives an insult to someone who he knows is going to be restrained. So they're both acts of fake courage. I mean, Tommy just lets Henry push him back toward the door. He could have pulled his gun and started shooting. He could have calmly walked over to Billy and then flipped and attacked him. And the throwing the glass at the floor, he could have threw the glass at Billy Bats. I've seen this before when someone throws a glass at the floor. It's a weird one. It's like they're announcing that they're going to kick off and hit someone, but they're not actually going to do it. It's just a gesture. So this is basically like two birds flashing their fighting feathers. By the way, an important little detail here is that Jimmy grabs Tommy's arm immediately after the insult, almost like he knew what was coming, but he's very casual in how he does this. He neither moves from his position nor says anything to Tommy or to Billy. And then we see his hand pushing Tommy's girl toward him. It seems to me he's giving Tommy the message to go and get the date out the way. He's not telling Tommy to calm down, he's telling him to hold back for now, to not lose control. There's definitely some sort of communication going on between Jimmy and Tommy here, because when Tommy comes back, he and Jimmy attack Bats as if it was a premeditated plan. But they didn't discuss it when Tommy kicked off. Maybe the two of them have been in situations before where they needed to mutually take down someone who'd insulted one of them, and so they have an instinctive mutual response to these outside aggressors. Jimmy is the one who most keeps his cool here, knowing that he's got his message across to Tommy to hold fire until later. It's possible, though, that Tommy could have made a phone call to the bar to arrange with Jimmy what they were going to do, but we're given no indication that that's what happened. More likely, Tommy saying, "Keep him here," got the message across to Jimmy, even though he said it to Henry.
Oh, fuck! Keep that motherfucker here! Keep him here!
Bats is there with his unusual hand gestures again, then shouting and chastising Henry and pointing quite aggressively at Jimmy as he appeals indirectly to the notion of his superior crime world status.
Sorry, Tommy gets a little loaded. He doesn't mean any disrespect.
You don't mean any disrespect, Henry. Are you nuts? Teach this kid a little fucking manners. Hey, Jimmy, what's right is right. You understand what I'm talking about?
It's all right.
That wasn't a wise move because he already insulted Jimmy earlier about being an Irish hoodlum. Big contradiction in terms here, too.
Teach this kid a little fucking manners.
Swearing and demanding manners at the same time. He called Tommy a kid as well, reinforcing his notion that Tommy is still just a shoeshiner. And Billy goes into pure bullshit mode now.
All right. No, I mean, the kids over here, we're hugging and kissing over here, and 2 minutes later he's acting like a fucking jerk.
No, they weren't hugging and kissing. Tommy shook hands with Billy and Billy pulled him in for a hug. There was certainly no kissing, or maybe that's what Billy wanted. Jimmy's response here is a mysterious one. He's probably already decided Bats is going to die tonight, so why challenge him about his behaviour?
2 minutes later, he's acting like a fucking jerk.
No. You insulted him a little bit. You got a little out of order yourself.
No, I didn't insult him.
Him a little bit.
No, I didn't insult nobody. Give us a drink.
Okay.
He clearly placates Billy with false surrender and false smile. As Henry says in the narration toward the end of the film, your killers come with smiles. Jimmy's not scared of this guy, he's putting him off guard. So my impression is that he verbally challenged Bats here about his behaviour because he wants Bats to know why he's going to die when the moment comes. And I think it's a personal underhanded fuck you as well, because Bats has personally insulted Jimmy tonight as well. Bats has a conflicted response to Jimmy, possibly because Jimmy has a legendary reputation in the crime world and is known for doing paid murders. So surely even a man like Bats would be hesitant in insulting him, at least outright. Billy denies what Jimmy is saying, but instead of arguing about the stupid details, he turns away and tries to distract by ordering drinks.
I didn't insult nobody. Give us a drink.
Okay.
And Jimmy outsmarts him, though.
Come on, let's have some drinks, all right? Drinks on the house. Come on, let me...
Yeah, no, have the drink with me.
No.
Billy.
No.
Drinks around the house.
Come on.
He's actually playing and beating Bats at his own game now. Remember at the start of the scene, Bats had insulted Jimmy while ordering him a drink? Well, now Jimmy's doing it the other way round. He's insulting Bats by taking control of the situation away and letting him know who's really bossing here, who's giving the orders, with the barman as the metaphor for that. But also disguising that insult behind a charitable free drinks framing. This is all very well conceived stuff, really well thought out in terms of script and acting. So Billy ends this chunk of the scene with some childish comments. Actually, it was already a broken up party, being that the guests were divided into opposing camps before Tommy walked in. The use of music in this scene is very sneaky, by the way. The volume of the song climbs and dips to accentuate specific moments, and the music completely stops the moment that Tommy leaves with his date. That's when everything changes and Billy Bats is doomed, basically. And there's the role of alcohol, which is easy to underestimate. Billy might be a much more pleasant guy when he's not drinking, if for some reason alcohol brings out a demonic side in certain people who were probably best not drinking in the first place. But we don't get to see Billy not drunk in this film, so we've got no idea about that. Oh, one other thing. Bats may seem like an arsehole, but can you imagine how much more psychotically aggressive Tommy would be if he had a mafia family backing him up? So on to the beating portion of the scene. A couple are seen leaving, but these two weren't present during the argument. If they were, then they were off screen somewhere and probably were just average nobodies, as Henry would put it. So them witnessing Tommy walking in wouldn't mean a thing to them.
I did my fucking time, Jimmy.
The music is a song called Atlantis by Donovan, and it's spouting some strange lyrics about the blind elders of our times. Hey, maybe that refers to Billy not having a clue what's coming here. Being a sort of soft hippie song, it mismatches the scene, which works very well. Again, Billy thinks everything is all going okay and that he's having a nice personal chat with Jimmy, so I suppose the music fits on that level. Henry, not being in on the murder plot, goes over to stop Tommy, but seeing Tommy reach for his gun, Henry steps aside quietly. Billy is talking to Jimmy, and though his description is crude, Billy confirms that he's got kids who are dependent on him.
I come home, and I want what I gotta get. I got fucking mouths to feed. Understand?
So yeah, they're about to make some kids fatherless. And for what? Over a trading of petty insults that are essentially no different than kids arguing in a playground. Nice. Sneaky Jimmy has no doubt positioned himself so that Bats will have his back to the door during the conversation, thus making him vulnerable. And though we can think of Tommy as utterly psycho here, Jimmy actually sits and has a personal one-to-one conversation with this guy about his life right before killing him. Tommy does similar with Stax Edwards, but that was just a momentary greeting. This has undoubtedly been a lengthy conversation, and Jimmy's probably gone out of his way to get Billy even more drunk too. So in a way, Jimmy's more psycho than Tommy. He's a controlled psycho. Tommy's an out-of-control one. Tommy gets close up and personal and waits for Bats to turn and look him in the eye before attacking. He wants Bats to know who kills him.
Fucking mouths to feed. Understand?
Yeah.
Get the door!
So the onslaught of kicks and gun smashes in the face ensues, and Henry looks all shocked, but he isn't nearly as innocent here as he might seem. He's quick to close and lock the door, at least for the sake of self-preservation, being that this is his property that Bats is being killed on. And he's not a stranger to this kind of violence himself, because remember, he did this.
You want something?
Hey. Henry didn't kill this guy, but he could have easily done so. This fella could have been brain injured from this. Henry certainly seems as vicious and dangerous as Tommy in this scene, and if the opportunity had been there to kill this guy, would Henry have done it? For some reason, Jimmy appears as angry as Tommy here, the two of them struggling to get past each other to inflict pain and damage. So is there something else going on for Jimmy? I don't think it's just personal loyalty to Tommy. Maybe being Irish and therefore excluded from full mob membership is a sore point for him. Maybe this is a chance to take out some of that frustration against someone who is a mob member. Though this scene can be considered brutal, I think it's handled quite maturely. We see these two throwing hits, but we see very little of Billy's face. The splashes of blood tell us enough, and the sudden increase in music volume is used to soften the emotional blow for the audience. Otherwise, this would have been terrifying.
I got fucking mouths to feed. Pretty good. Understand? Pretty good. Yeah. Get the door!
Now, I'm not quite sure what happens here when Tommy drops the gun. He's knocked back by Jimmy. Surely Jimmy knew that Bats would have to be killed to avoid the mob backlash. Did he simply not want any gunshots going off here that might be heard externally? I don't know. It's a strange little piece of editing, and I just don't understand what happened there. And it's not in the script either. In the script, Tommy actually brings a plastic sheet with him to the bar to put Billy's body in, confirming the intention absolutely was to commit murder. But in the film, he uses some of Henry's tablecloths, arrogantly throwing items about the place in the process, which is a contradiction with this line.
I don't want to get blood on your floor.
And that's kind of like Jimmy's contradictory complaining that Bats has ruined his shoes.
Fucking mud into my shoes.
Adding to the premeditation, Jimmy has already thought about body disposal too.
What are we going to do with him? We can't just dump him on the street.
Don't worry, I know a place upstate. They'll never find him. Come on, let's get some more tablecloths.
After this, there's the scene of picking up a shovel from Tommy's mother's house. I'm not going to explore that scene here, as this video is long enough already, and it would mean delving into some other subjects that I want to save for other videos on Goodfellas. So finishing off, there's a recap of Bats' final death moment in the boot of the car, with Henry giving a voiceover explanation about the function of murder in the crime world.
Murder was the only way that everybody stayed in line. You got out of line, you got whacked. Everybody knew the rules. But sometimes, even if people didn't get out of line, they got whacked. I mean, hits just became a habit for some of the guys.
The narration is straightforward, but the editing is bizarre, and quite cool actually. Slow motion of the jittery frame variation, and things shown a little bit out of sequence, like Henry opening the trunk and then showing it closed again, and the cut and fat back and forth between burying Billy Bats and beating him up in the bar. I think the whole point of this bizarre editing here is that it's disjointed and fuzzy like a memory. We've already seen the straightforward editing of Billy's final moments right at the beginning of the movie. So this scene shows a version in the way it's been imprinted on Henry's brain. After all, he is narrating over this, like it's the past. The muffled sounds kind of fit with that too.
Guys would get into arguments over nothing, and before you knew it, one of them was dead. Killed a made guy. Bats was part of the Gambino crew and was considered untouchable. Before you could touch...
Sometimes our distant memories are like that. The sounds are faded, the editing is all broken up so that only the most emotional high points are recalled. I mean, when we, as the audience, think back to this scene itself, we don't recall everything in full sequence. We don't remember every individual line of dialogue and every camera shot in the exact order. We recall a mixed chronology of key moments, the shinebox lines, the actual beating, etc. So I really like this bizarre editing sequence here. It's very original. Weirdly, Henry is the one who digs the grave, though he didn't commit the murder. And he also did all of the driving to get the body out here. So is he just following orders out of fear now? The end of the scene hints at his fears of being next. He closes the trunk, freeze frame, and fade in of intense red along with sounds like the sizzling of a frying pan.
The sit down, and you better get an okay or you'd be the one who got whacked.
Seems that Henry really is feeling the heat, the danger inherent to the lifestyle he's chosen. And remember that in the original opening version of this scene at the start of the movie, the red tail lights were used to give a hellish glow. Okay, that's it then. A marvellously intricate scene or sequence of scenes. And I've got to give a massive shout out to the key actors here. The three leads, Ray Liotta, Robert De Niro, Joe Pesci, they're all brilliant throughout the whole movie, of course. But Frank Vincent Gattuso Jr., that's a hell of a name, isn't it? He is outstanding as Billy Batts. Joe Pesci is incredible, of course, but for me, this is Gattuso's scene. He is absolutely believable in this role. The outstanding script and direction helps, of course, but a scene like this requires top-tier acting, and that's what we get. By the way, I thought of something funny while writing this video. Wouldn't it have been hilarious if Tommy had come back with his shine box from when he was younger and then proceeded to shine Billy's face after beating him up? Or if after Jimmy had kicked Billy's face in repeatedly, he'd told Tommy to shine the blood off his shoes? Anyway, those are all ideas for a comedy reenactment if anyone's thinking about it. You've been listening to Rob Ager. Thanks for watching. More videos and articles at collativelearning.com. Bye-bye.